Hello and welcome dear students. Today we will be discussing about co-evolution of flower vis-a-vis pollinators. Angiosperms exhibit an astonishing variety of flower shapes. Understanding the evolution of this morphological diversity in flower has been an area of research in evolutionary biology for many years, producing ample information gathered on macroevolution and developmental genetics of floral shapes. From the very beginning of life on planet Earth, flora and fauna share a symbiotic relationship, each being essential for the other's survival and reproduction. Without insects and birds to carry pollen, many plants would not be able to share their genetic material with one another. These pollinators do not intentionally carry pollen between plants, they only use plants as a food source. In return for their pollinating service, these insects and birds are rewarded in the future when new plants grow. Flowering plants depend upon external agents to carry pollen from male parts in the flowers of one plant to the female parts of the flowers of another plant or even to the same plant. The flowers of each species are modified in shape, structure, color, and odor to the particular pollinating agents on which they depend, providing clear picture of the evolution of adaptedness. Evolving together, the plants and their pollinators become more finely tuned to each other's peculiarities, a process often termed as co-evolution. In co-evolution, each of the species involved serve as a source of natural selective pressure on the other. Hence, a more formal definition for co-evolution is the mutual evolutionary influence between two species. Now, let's discuss about co-evolution and pollinating agencies. First of all, we will deal with wind-pollinated plants. It is believed that the early seed plants were wind pollinated and their ovules were borne on leaves or cones. For wind pollination, the flower have to produce small size pollens which can be carried by wind easily, like that of grasses, sedges, conifers and many other broad-leaved trees like birch, walnut, poplar, hazel and oak, etc. In spite of the fact that wind is an effective transporter and can take the tiny dry pollens up to a height of 19,000 feet and carry them for 300 miles, there are certain disadvantages also associated with wind pollinated plants, like production of large quantity of pollens constitute a significant loss to the plant and also the mechanism is totally haphazard. Now, let's see animal pollinated plants. To overcome the disadvantages of wind pollination and to ensure cross-fertilization, plants need to develop unique methods because they cannot move around like animals for mating purposes. For this purpose, most plants use insects and other animals as pollinators. And for that, they have adaptations to attract insects and transfer pollen to the insects. The insects have adaptations to allow them to find the plants and obtain food. In order to make use of animals as pollinators, plant must, number one, supply some reward or frequently food for the pollinator, that is in the form of nectar. Number two, advertise the presence of this to attract visitors in the form of fragrance. And number three, have a way of putting pollen on the pollinator so that it is transferred to the next plant. The reward is not always food, but mimicry for pseudocopulation and other purposes are also common attractants for the pollinators. The adaptations exhibited by any given flower depend on the type of pollinator the flower is designed to attract. Various pollinators have differing adaptations and means of gathering pollen or nectar, etc., from a flower. One thing that is very important to understand is that flowers apparently have no purpose but to attract organisms, and that this function has been preserved throughout their evolution, indicating that coevolution is the largest factor that allowed flowering plants to diversify so much. And this coevolution of flowers was with the most diverse taxonomic group on the planet Earth, the insects. In biology, the term coevolution, coined by Ehrlich and Draven in 1964, is the mutual evolutionary influence between two or more interdependent species, reflected in structural, physiological, or behavioral changes in the species related to their interaction. The mutual interrelations between entomophilous or zoophilous flowering plants and their pollinators include following types of coevolutionary systems. The first is obligate coevolution, in which the reproduction of each partner is closely and directly dependent on the other, including extreme one-to-one coevolution systems. For instance, the pollination of yucca plants by yucca moth. Number second is the diffuse coevolution of few to many facultative partners, as in many pollinator systems of bumblebees and other polylactic pollinators. In such a system, more than one type of pollinator exert a selective pressure on more than one plant. And the third type of coevolutionary system is asymmetrical coevolution with unbalanced reciprocal effects, such as occurs in oligolactic bees specializing on a few related plants as pollen sources. In such cases, a particular group of pollinators get adaptations in response to many related flowers. The coevolutionary process demands and produces some degree of specialization within biological communities. The spatio-temporal pattern of coevolutionary partners in pollination system and the variation in pollinators' visitation rates in response to floral display confines specialization of the plants to particular pollinators and may promote speciation through specialization. The angiosperms as a whole group, and in particular some families and genera of the angiospermy and various taxa of pollinators such as syrphid flies, bumblebee flies, pollen wasps, butterflies, bees, sphingid moths, hummingbirds and nectar birds, and many other, are the example of coevolutionary success attributable to the mutualistic relationships between the flowering plants and the pollinators. Now we will discuss coevolution and intimate relationships of plants and their pollinators. Plants and their pollinators begin evolving their intricate dance of codependency over 100 million years ago with the origin of flowering plants. They fine-tuned it during the Cenozoic era about 65 million years ago, as flowering plants began to dominate all the world's living landscapes. It's evident from the evolutionary studies that the association between beetles and the angiosperms during the early Cretaceous, around about 145 to 65.5 million years ago, has led to the parallel radiations of angiosperms and insects into the late Cretaceous. During the Cenozoic period, the first beetles, butterflies, moths, and wasps start appearing. Conveniently, at the same time, the flowering plants were diversifying. The significance in this is that these are insects for which flowers are often the only source of nutrition for the adults. Simultaneously, flowers were also specializing to attract a certain type of insect or animal to increase the chance of pollination. Hence, they were co-evolving. From this point on, certain plants and insect species have had a profound influence on one another's evolution. A flower that attracted specific pollinators on a regular basis had some advantages over flowers that attracted promiscuous pollinators. It's also an advantage for the pollinators to have its own private food source because there is thus less competition. The varied shapes, colors, and odors of flowers allowed sensory recognition by pollinators and excluded unwanted, indiscriminate pollinators. These selective pressures and advantages to plants and pollinators continued for millions of years. These millions of years of plant-pollinator coevolution have produced a world in which flowers have their structure, anatomy, and scents finely tuned to their pollinator partners. In exchange for pollination service, flowers provide food, shelter, and chemicals used by insects to produce such things as pheromones, which are necessary for their reproduction and perpetuation. Today, over 85% of angiosperms are insect pollinated, and 20% of insects, at least at some stages, depend on the flowers for their food. For effective pollination, a relationship must be established between the pollinators and the flower to be pollinated. And pollinators should visit this particular blossom regularly. The relationship between flowering plants and their pollinators is so intimate that with the decline or extinction of pollinator populations, the impact on their plant associates would be immediate and profound. Because pollinators are species upon which the lives of so many other species depend, they are regarded as keystone species. Pollinators are thus essential to the stability of the global ecosystem itself. In fact, without pollinators, life on planet Earth would be very different. The co-evolutionary interactions between species of plants and their pollinators are generally categorized as generic coevolution and specific coevolution. Now, let's understand some examples of coevolution. Insect pollination offers some of the more remarkable examples of the harmony between species. Coevolution has been offered as the means that such harmony has come about. Some of the common reasons of the relationship between plants and their pollinators are dependence, as in yucca and yucca moth; floral sonication, as in gentian and carpenter bees; benefit to flowers, as against defense against herbivory, as in passion flower and butterfly; benefit to flower as in mimicry and fakery like orchids and bee; and mutualistic relationship between moth and orchid or fly and flower. Now, let's discuss bee pollinated plants. Scientists have long believed that bees first appeared about 120 million years ago. But previous bee fossil records date back only about 65 million years. More than 16,000 species of bees, organized into 7 families, are known to exist. Bees are known to affect plant evolution by separating pollen and preferring to pollinate some types of plants over others. It has been assumed that bees have essentially always been around pollinating plants and creating new species. Bees are attracted innately to bright colors, ultraviolet bull eye patterns, and sweet aromatic or minty odors. They are active only during the day, and they usually alight on a petal before moving into the part of the flower containing the nectar and pollen. Blue flowers have showy, brightly colored petals that are usually blue or yellow, but hardly ever red. As bees can see blue or yellow light well, but they cannot see red at all. Indeed, most bee pollinated flowers have a UV bull's eye, a sweet aromatic or minty fragrance, daytime opening or nectar production, and a special protruding lip or other suitable landing platform. Bees depend heavily on scent, so certain flowers have developed heady scents to attract them. These observations clearly indicate that correspondence exists between certain flowers and the preference of bees. Now we discuss relationship between fig and fig wasps. Figs and fig wasps have evolved to help each other and are interdependent for reproduction. Fig wasps lay their eggs inside the fruit where the wasp larva can safely develop, and in return the wasp pollinate the figs. Fig wasps are responsible for pollinating almost 1000 species of figs. These wasps and fig trees are obligate mutualists, meaning that they cannot reproduce without each other. The mutualistic relationship between the fig trees and fig wasps is co-evolutional and highly obligated. Each fig species generally has its own wasp symbiont as pollinator. The wasp on the other side is host specific. The specificity is advantageous to both fig trees and fig wasps. Now we see the example of orchids and wasp pseudo copulation system. A particularly dramatic example of adaptation for pollination is seen in some species of orchids whose flowers resemble in shape, order and color to the female of certain species of wasps, bees or flies. The male insect is stimulated to attempt to copulate with the flower and becomes covered with pollen in the process. When he later attempts to copulate with another flower, some of the pollen from the first flower is deposited on the second. So complete is deception that sperm have actually been found inside the orchid flowers after a visit by the male insect. Now see the example of beetles as pollinators. Beetles pollinated flowers are also called as cantharophyllous. Beetles are among the first insects to visit flowers and they remain essential pollinators today as well. Fossil records show that beetles were abundant during the Mesozoic about 200 million years before present. Hence they were flower visitors of the earliest angiosperms. Many present day beetle pollination associations like that of Magnolia, a primitive woody angiosperm, have ancient evolutionary origins. Beetles will eat their way through petals and other floral parts. Research has shown that beetles are capable of color vision. The flowers that are visited by beetles are typically bowl shaped with sexual organs exposed, white to dull white or green, strongly fruity, open during the day, moderate nectar producers, may be large, solitary or in clusters of small flowers. Now we analyze butterflies and moth pollination systems. Butterflies and moths with their long hollow proboscis can sip nectar from flowers with more elongated floral tubes than insects with shorter tongues can. Favorite butterfly plants include sweety fragranced flowers with tubular blooms such as lantana and honeysuckle. Butterflies taste with their feet and are very active during the day and visit a variety of wildflowers. However, they are generally less efficient than bees at moving pollen between plants. Highly perched on their long thin legs, they do not pick much pollen on their bodies and lack specialized structures for collecting it. Butterflies are diurnal and have good vision, that is, can see red color as well, but a weak sense of smell. They are perching feeders. Butterfly pollinated flowers are brightly colored but odorless. Often these flowers occur in clusters as in family Compositae and are designated with a landing platform. Butterflies walk around a flower cluster, probing the blossoms with their tongues. Each flower has a tube of suitable length for the butterfly's tongue. Many butterflies produce scents that attract the opposite sex. Many of these scents often smell like the flowers that they are attracted to and visit. The scents of these butterfly pollinated flowers might have evolved as an adaptation that made use of the existing attractiveness of these scents. Moths play a role in a particular interesting adaptation of plants to their pollinators. Moths are nocturnal, have a good sense of smell, and are hover feeders. The flowers they pollinate are white or pale color, so they are visible at night and may only be open at night. Typically, these flowers have a strong, sweet scent, again maybe only at night, and deep tubes to match the length of the appropriate moth's tongue. The petals are flat or bent back, that is recurved, so the moth can get in. Let's have an example of yucca moth and yucca plants. An interesting story is displayed by yucca moth and yucca plant. Yucca flowers are of such a shape that only tiny moths can pollinate them. The moth lay their eggs in the yucca flowers, and the larva live in the developing ovary and eat yucca seeds. The yucca plant is dependent upon the yucca moth for its survival and perpetuation. The pistil of each flowers end in a three-lobed stigma. In order for pollination to occur, masses of pollen must be forced down into the central stigmatic hole. The female yucca moth gathers pollen from the flower anthers by using her specially adapted moth parts. She forms the sticky pollen into a ball. The pollen ball is then stuffed or combed into the stigma of the various flowers she visits. Without this process, the yucca flower will not develop into fruit or pod with seeds. When the female moth visits the flower, she backs up to the flower base and inserts her ovipositor to lay an egg in one or more of the six chambers of the ovary. The chamber protects the egg while it develops. By the time the egg hatches into a microscopic caterpillar, the yucca will have begun to develop a pod with little seeds. The yucca and the yucca moth both benefit in the relationship and are obligate mutualists. Have an example of arengide orchid and African moths. The long-spurred arengide orchids in Kenya have highly specialized pollination systems, involving just a few long-tongued hawk moth species. It has been demonstrated that these orchids are exclusively pollinated by long-tongued hawk moths. No more than 1 to 2 hawk moth species pollinate a much larger number of specialized orchids. The diversity of the arengide orchid is suggestive of an adaptive radiation and represents an example of plants that have diversified in their pollination strategies. Long-tongued hawk moth and the long-tubed flowers they pollinate are likely to have co-evolved in a diffuse sense. The symmetry of the long-tongued hawk moth pollination system means that the evolution of the floral traits of individual plants is far more likely to be influenced by particular hawk moths than is the reverse. Now let's examine snapdragons and bumblebees. The snapdragon has unique ways of inviting the right kind of pollinators to it by scent, color, and physical form. During the day when bumblebees are most active, snapdragons release 4 times more scent than at night. This scent attracts many pollinators, including bumblebees. When a bumblebee does land on the flower, the scent, which is only on the lobes of the petals, is carried back to the hives, attracting more bees to the plant. The sturdy, irregular bell shape of the flower also designates what kind of pollinator may have access to its nectar. The bell form of the flower fits the shape of a bumblebee's body, so that when it enters the close quarters of the flower, the pollen sticks to the fur of the bee, or else the bees collect the pollen in specially modified areas on their legs. This pollen is then carried with the bee as it goes to collect more pollens from other flowers. Snapdragons are designed for a bumblebee of just the right weight to trip the opening mechanism. Other insects which are too small or too heavy cannot trigger the opening of the opening to gain access to nectar which lies on the other side of the small narrow floral tubes. Janshana and bumblebees. A good display of co-evolution is observed in pink Janshana, their Sabbatia angular species, growing in southern Africa, which is pollinated by handsome furry carpenter bees. The flowers of the Janshana spread their petals wide to expose curving white styles and three large stamens. Each stamen ends in a long thick anther that seems to be covered in yellow pollen, an obvious temptation to many passing pollen feeding insects. But that's something of an illusion. The yellow anther is hollow and the pollens are held aside. The only way they can escape is through a tiny hole right at the top of the anther, and there's only one way of extracting it. The carpenter bee arrives at the flower, making a high pitched buzzing noise with its wings as most bees do. As it alights on an anther, it continues beating its wings but lowers the frequency so that the note of its buzz suddenly falls to approximately half. This causes the anther to vibrate at just the right frequency needed to release the pollen, and the grains sprout out of the hole at the top in a yellow fountain. Now we examine bird pollinated flowers. Bird pollinated flowers are called ornithophilous flowers. Birds have keen sight. This makes bright flowers attract to them. The flowers are mostly bell shaped and large in size and with copious dilute nectar. The essential organs of these flowers project out. Birds, especially hummingbirds, have good eyes which especially can see red color but have poor sense of smell. These flowers are brightly colored, especially red, but have no smell and have recurved petals so that they are out of the way. Hummingbirds are hoover feeders, and these flowers, for example columbine and fuchsia, are designed to dust the bird's head with pollen. Since flowers of the same genus can have very different morphologies to suit different pollinators, it is probably the flowers that have done most of the adapting. Bat pollinated flowers. The bat pollinated flowers are called Cheiroptrophilous flowers. These flowers generally are large and open only at night and usually dark colored, but with a strong musky odor, which is the odor of bats, and the bats are attracted for the flowers. About 130 genera of angiosperms are bat pollinated, for example Kygelia, Durio, Erythrina and Adansonia, etc. Flies and ants. Flies are attracted to rotting flesh. These flowers may be dull colored or may be brownish red with a bad rotten smell as their main attractor. Unlike bees and moths, the short tongued flies are attracted by rank rather than sweet odors, and they rely very little on vision in locating food. The flowers of plants that depend on these flies for pollination are usually dull colored and ill smelling. Some flowers near the ground are pollinated by ants, as they do not have the services of aerial pollinators. It is evident from the above examples that the characteristics of flowers are not simply pleasing curiosities of nature that serve no practical function. They are important adaptations that have evolved in response to fundamental selection pressures. Flowering plants have co-evolved with their pollinator partners over millions of years, producing a fascinating and interesting diversity of floral strategies and pollinator adaptations. The great variety in color, form, and scent we see in flower is a direct result of the intimate association of flowers with pollinators. 80% of the plants are pollinated with other organisms, 19.8% by wind and 0.2% by water. The relationship between flowers and pollinators is not always mutualistic. In many cases, there is an antagonistic relationship between the plants and their pollinators as well. Some plants and pollinators cheat at the game of pollinating by reaping the benefits of the partnership without costs. Today we discussed about various types of co-evolutionary mechanisms which led to the diversification of angiosperm flora. Hope it will help you to understand the process of co-evolution of flowers vis-a-vis pollinators. Thank you very much.